Good afternoon. Thank you very much for staying here. And I'm going to talk about an algorithm for searching Hankel superregular matrices for using decoding convolutional code over the Irisul channel. This is a joint work with Vicente Galeano and Isabel Remy. The talk is structured as follows. In the first section, we will so which kind of codes are used in the result channel. In the second section, we describe the convolutional codes from linear systems theory viewpoint. And the third section, we study how to decode convolutional codes over the result channel. And finally, we will give our algorithm for searching superregular Hankel matrices. Over the Irisul channel, mainly block codes have been used. And the use of convolutional codes over the Irisul channel has been studied much less. Thomas Rosenthal and Smaravet shows that MDP convolutional codes can recover patterns of Irisul that cannot be decoded by an MDS block code. Also, they define a subclass of MDP convolutional codes called reverse maximum distance profile convolutional codes. These codes allow an inversion of the direction of decoding from the right to the left. So we can recover through a backward process more errors than an MDP code. In the following, we assume that F is a finite field of Q elements, and a convolutional code for a Kn and complexity delta can be described by the linear system that is given with these equations, where the matrices A, B, C, D are of this size. And Xt is the state vector, Ut is the formation vector, Yt is the parity vector, and Vt is the code vector. It's at time t. This representation was presented by Rosenthal, Schumacher, and York, and is known as the input state upper representation of a convolutional code. And it has been used for constructing convolutional codes and study convolutional codes. Consider these two matrices. The first matrix is called the controllability matrix, and the second one is the observability matrix of the convolutional code. So we say that the pair AB is controllable if the controllable matrix has full row rank. And we say that the pair AC is observable if the observable matrix, so the observability matrix, has full column rank. The free distance of a convolutional code is a major parameter of a convolutional code because it determines the capability of a convolutional code over maximum likelihood decoding. In terms of the input state upper representation, the free distance is given by this expression, where the minimum is taken over all the colors known there. Also, the column distance will be very important in our talk. Is there are defined by this expression, and it determines the minimum distance between truncated code words. Rosenthal and Desmarandage establish an upper bound of the free distance of a cumulus alcohol. It generalizes the single turbo for block codes, and this is given by this expression. So we say that C is a maximum distance separable code if its free distance attains the generalized Chingitol bound. Also, we say that C has maximum distance profile if the column distance attains its maximum value. Observe that the maximality of the column distance implies the maximality of the previous one. By writing the equation that describes a convolutional code, we get this homogeneous system that is known as the local description of trajectories. And in the rest of the talk, this template matrix will be an interest. No? So we define this template matrix, and this template matrix characterizes the MDP convolutional codes. In fact, an MDP convolutional code is an MDP convolutional code if and only if this template matrix has the property that if every minor which is non-trivial is zero, is non-zero. Next, we present how MDP convolutional codes can be used to decoding over result channel. Thomas, in her PhD thesis, established the following result. Let's see be an MDP convolutional code. Then if any sliding window of this length L plus 1, at most L plus 1 times N minus K ELSUS occurs in a transmitted sequence, then we can recover the sequence in polynomial time. Assume that we receive correctly the information sequence up to instant T minus 1, and this implies that we know the state at time t. So from the local description of trajectories, we get this homogeneous system, where the asterisk denotes a block where components are irresolute. Since C is an MDP convolutional code, we know that every minor of this matrix, which is non-trivial zero, is non-zero. Okay, so we can select the columns corresponding to the components irresolute, and the rest of the columns we will give the independent term of the linear system, and with these columns we get a non-homogeneous linear system with the property that the matrix of the coefficients has a full rank, so it has a unique solution and we can recover their sequence. Observe that since the maximality of the column distance L implies the maximality of all the previous ones, then the window size in the process is not fixed. And we can adapt to the distribution of the resource in the sequence. Okay, we can recover the sequence, but when too many resources happen at a certain point in the sequence, the system presented above don't have a unique solution. So we cannot recover the sequence and the state. In this section, we present certain conditions in which one can compute the state. Let's see be an NK data convolutional code. Then we can recalculate the state of the system when we observe a clean window of this length, when mu is the observability index of the pair AC. Assume that a big burst of errors not possible to recover occurred at instant T0, and if we slide down along the sequence, such all the symbols have been correctly resolved, then we have this homogeneous equation. Well, when observe that this column matrix is this matrix, sorry, is the observability matrix of the pair AC. So we know that the rank of this matrix, since AC is an observable pair, is delta. Then there are delta rows of this matrix which for which the minor is non-zero. So we can restrict this system with these delta rows, and we compute the independent terms with the information of the parity vectors, and we get a linear system, non-homogeneous linear system, with delta equations and delta variables, which has a unique solution. So we can recover the state. Observe that the observability index ensures that the rank of the observability matrix is delta. However, we don't know which rows of this observability matrix are linearly independent. Imposing some conditions on the observability matrix of the code, we can control which are the rows that have a minor non-zero of time delta times delta. This is this is the result that this theorem shows. If there is an index, so the observability matrix represents the transpose of the parity check matrix of MNDS block code, then we can calculate the state of the system when you observe a clean window of this length. Okay, assume that the recovery process was interrupted at distance T0 because a block with too many errors was resolved. And from the local description on trajectories, we have this homogeneous system, where the asterisk denotes the state vector that we want to recover. Okay, since the observability matrix is the transpose of a parity check matrix of a block code, we know that that any delta rows are linearly independent. In particular, we can restrict ourselves to the first delta equations, and we need to observe this number of correct information vector with the corresponding delta parity symbols to compute the independent terms of the non-homogeneous system. This system has a unique solution because the coefficient matrix has full rank, and we can recover XT. Observe that the MDS condition on the observability matrix of the system helps us to diminish the length of the clean window that we need to receive in order to recover the state. But this implies to wait until a certain number of contiguous non-erased symbols happen. Since not only bursts of errors can be occurred, the waiting time for a clean window can become considerable. So, Thomas, in her thesis, shows that if we choose our subspaces with alpha, where alpha is this number, generated these subspaces by certain columns of this matrix, and each of these subspaces verifies that there are in direct sum with the subspace generated by the columns of the observability matrix, then we can recalculate the state of the system when we observe a window of length L plus 1 times L, where not more than this number or ESUS occurs. So, these results allows us to recover the state of the system and the part of the sequence in the window at the same time. Moreover, we don't need to observe a complete clean block. But the question is, which convolutional code verifies the hypothesis of the above result? Okay, if we choose that the in order to generate a convolutional code that satisfies the conditions of the above theorem, they must verify that the columns of the observability matrix and any alpha columns of the Teplitz matrix are linearly independent. So, if we choose our matrices describing the convolutional code in such a way that this matrix is a proper submatrix of a superregular matrix, then the convolutional code satisfies the conditions of the above theory. So, our aim is to obtain superregular matrices of size R times R over a fixed Galois field and where the size is fixed. Now we are going to explain our algorithm for the program to get a superregular Hankel matrix. Let H be a super Hankel matrix of size I times I, defined as this matrix, and if we get this permutation matrix, we get a with the this multiplication, we get a lower triangular Teplitz matrix, and this Teplitz matrix is a superregular Teplitz matrix if and only if the Hankel matrix is superregular. So we want to make a program in order to get all the superregular Hankel matrix of a fixed size and over a fixed Galois field, and with this permutation we get a superregular Teplitz matrix that we can use to obtain a convolutional code which verifies the conditions of the above theorem of Thomas. So, with this program, we generate all the Hankel matrices of size, of fixed size, over a given finite field, and the algorithm is divided in two parts, and spacive construction and inward analysis. The data of the program is given by the parameters of the Gauss field and the size of the Henkel matrices, the superregular Henkel matrices that we want to take. And the result is all the Henkel, the superregular Henkel matrices of the fixed size over the Gauss field. In the initial case or system, we begin with a trivial superregular Henkel matrix of size 2 times 2 over the Gauss field that is fixed. This is a trivial superregular Henkel matrix, and in the next step we increase the size of this matrix and check if the new matrix is superregular. Observe that the matrix H3 contains the superregular matrix H2, and the minors of the H2 are non-zero. So in this step we have to compute only if this minor is non-zero in order to H3 be a superregular Henkel matrix. If that minor of H3 it has non-zero determinant, then H3 is a superregular Henkel matrix. And we increase the size of the matrix in order to look for a bigger superregular Henkel matrix. We obtain H4 that contains H3 also, and we add, as previous steps, a new element in the position 1, 1, that is in first row and first column. So we know that H3 is a superregular Henkel matrix, so we don't have to compute the minors of H3. Then, which minors we have to compute at this step? We have to compute the minors of these three matrices. All the matrices has to contain the new element. In general, at step I, if Hi minus 1 is a superregular Henkel matrix of size I times I, we increase this matrix and we obtain Hi, where this, the element of the position 1, 1 is one element of the Gauss field, is the new element in this step. It contains also the above superregular Henkel matrices, so we have to compute all the minors of all sides, minors non-trivially zero, which contains the element of the first column A and first row. And the process can be iterated recursively. So, we begin to get a trivial superregular matrix, and we want, with this command, with this function, we want to get all the superregular Henkel matrices of size S max, and P, K are the parameters of the Gauss field, and FF is a primitive element of the Gauss field. Okay, so we, in the first step of the algorithm, we increase the size of the first Henkel, superregular Henkel matrix that is trivial. And we get a matrix of this size. The matrix of this size, when we iterate, this matrix contains the superregular Henkel matrix of the step of the previous step. So we put in this matrix the corresponding elements of the superregular Hankel matrix of the previous step. And then we get the new element of position 1,1 by computing all the elements of the Galois field. When we get an element of the Galois field, we check if the determinant of all the submatrices containing this element, which minor non-trivially, not trivially zero, is zero or not zero. If it is zero, then we have to check with another element of the Galois field. If it is non-zero, then we get a superregular Hankel matrix and we want to increase the size of the matrix. So this, with this program we get all the superregular Hankel matrices of a fixed size and a fixed Galois field. And with the corresponding permutation we get superregular Teplitz matrix. In order to get a good convolutional code to the coding over the eraser channel. So, we make a program that seeks superregular Hankel matrices to use for using in the coding convolutional code of the eraser channel, and as future works, we want to study reverse MDP convolutional code from linear systems point of view, and also we want to implement reverse MDP convolutional code over any finite field. That's all. Thank you very much for your attention.